charge them so much a game?
Hello and welcome to Sports Opinion, the weekly sports talk show on Channel 18. That's Public Access TV. My name is Dirk Keller. Got my friend Pat White back.
Hi,
and
Dirk.
We've got my friend Bud Supel back. And as always, Earl Murphy's here because, by golly, it's his show for 28 years running. That's right, 28 years Sports Opinion right here on Public Access TV. We appreciate you tuning in, and we are here to talk about the Hawkeyes. And this week, it's not just about Hawkeye football. Believe it or not, Hawkeye basketball starts tomorrow night. So we've got lots to talk about, as usual. And we're going to start off by talking about the top 10 ranked Iowa Hawkeye football team.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. Feels good.
Yes.
Feels
really
good.
Nobody would ever guess that.
Nope, nobody did.
No.
But you guys picked the Hawks to be undefeated, right?
Yeah,
I did.
And you?
Yeah, I'm out of predictions. But up until the Illinois game, I had us undefeated, and after that, I didn't know. But even so, I don't think anybody thought we'd make the top 10.
Mm-mm. No way.
It's great.
It feels good.
And they're playing that. They're playing like a top 10 team.
Are they?
I think so.
What makes you say that?
Well, you go on the road and you beat two top 20 teams.
Yeah.
You have to be.
Well, aren't you tired of pundits saying we've got a weak schedule?
Yeah, right.
We're the only team that's beat Illinois State.
Right.
We're the only team that's beat Pitt. They've won every game except ours.
Right. Good boy.
We beat Wisconsin and Northwestern when they were ranked on the road.
On the road.
Yes.
Yeah.
There isn't any other Big Ten team that's beaten ranked teams on the road.
No. There's only one other team in the nation who's beaten two top 25 teams on the road, and that's Alabama.
Yeah.
That's Alabama. There's only one team in the nation who's given up a total of one rushing touchdown. That's Iowa.
That's still us, isn't it?
Yep.
And that was done by Illinois, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Who gained, what, a total of 50-some yards the whole game. I think you're right, Earl. So there are a lot of things to like about this Hawkeye team, and there are a lot of things to like about the game coming up Saturday with Maryland at Kinnick Stadium. The game time is 2:30 on ABC, which right there it tells you how good the Hawks are.
Yeah, twice.
Yeah.
ABC twice.
2:30. Yeah. Just any 2:30 start means you're a better team.
That's right.
Usually. And Maryland is an interesting team. Their record is 2-5. They are 0-3 in the Big Ten Conference. They have the teams they beat were Richmond and South Florida. Those are the only two teams they beat. And they have accumulated losses to Bowling Green rather handily, 48-27. They lost at West Virginia. Oh, and that Bowling Green loss was at home. They lost at West Virginia, 45-6, and they lost to Michigan at home, 28-0. And then, let's see, they also lost at Ohio State, 49-28. And then Penn State came to Baltimore last weekend, where they played the game, and they beat Maryland 31-30. It was a rather good game.
Yeah, it was.
I don't know about you guys. You catch part of that game on TV?
I did, they played Ohio State reasonably well.
I thought so, too.
Better than expected.
Yeah.
They got a little hat back.
Well, they've got some small guys, including maybe their best defensive player is a cornerback.
Mike Likely.
Will Likely.
Will Likely. Thank you.
5'7". He had a pick six against us last year. Mm-hmm. He's run... I think he may be up to like 6 punt returns for touchdowns.
He's got 2 for career?
His career.
Yeah. He's got 2 this year. He leads the Big Ten in punt return average, just under 20 per punt.
Nobody, he's so small, nobody can see him.
Yeah. Nobody else returns punts for them, or has yet.
Yeah.
He comes out of a whole bunch of people. And he goes,
right.
Will likely. He's, you know, the other thing to note about Maryland is that they are third in the Big Ten in rushing offense average per game. They average 186 yards per game. The Hawkeyes are second in the Big Ten at 214 yards per game. So we've got two teams with similar strengths in the running game.
But how did they lose all those games?
By giving up a lot of points.
That Florida team is terrible. I watched them the other night.
Well, here's what's...
Bowling Green's not bad.
No, like Bowling Green's right. I think they're the best.
They're one of the top teams in the MAC.
Speaking of the MAC, did Toledo get beat last week? They were losing.
They were, but I think they pulled it out.
Did they?
Yeah.
Here's something else, statistically speaking. Iowa ranks second in the Big Ten in rush defense. The Hawkeyes only give up 74 yards in rushing per game, while Maryland ranks 13th. They give up 175 yards rushing per game.
They'll do better this week.
Well, one of the things that makes that particular statistic even more interesting is we're playing without our best all-Big Ten defender.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Drew Ott. It makes a huge difference. And
is he coming back this year?
No, he's done.
Not at all.
His career is over.
Son of a gun.
Well, and that's partly the victim of my, I keep criticizing our redshirt policy. We did it again last week.
Son
I played only half a season as a freshman. So he's in effect done having played the equivalent of 3 years.
And who did we bring in last year?
Jack Hockaday. We brought in to play on the kickoff and punt teams.
Where's he from?
Someplace in Illinois. I mean, he's presumably going to be good. He's a linebacker, but
and we brought
I don't
him
understand
in for special
why,
teams.
Why you'd waste a half a year to play a true freshman on special teams.
I'm with you.
I mean, they're important. Don't get me wrong, but I guess injuries are part of the reason.
Probably.
I think it's a shame.
Probably.
Doesn't Maryland run out of gas at the end?
Yeah, they run out of gas.
Well, and they've fired their coach. They're playing with an interim coach.
Yeah.
Let's talk about him for a little bit.
Randy Edsall was their coach. He came from Connecticut, where Bobby Diaco is now the coach. And I've never thought Randy Edsall was a top-notch coach, but he's clean-cut, well-spoken, look the part of a big-time college
coach.
Why
did they get rid of him?
Well, they weren't winning.
They were, yeah.
You know, the phenomenon that is really ominous this year, I think, is firing coaches in the middle of the season.
I do, too.
Miami did it this week with a guy that's got a winning record.
Al Golden. They embarrassed themselves 58-0. Who did he play?
Clemson.
Who's one of the top five teams in the country.
Absolutely. Clemson's terrific, and they beat the heck out of Miami. But Miami is still 4-3, and
they
fired the coach.
They fired him.
Dan McCartney. A lot of people have. Yeah. Like, anybody's going to make that program better before this season's over. I don't get it. Now,
well, Mike Loxley, who's the interim coach at Maryland, knows us.
Very well.
He was Ron Zook's offensive coordinator first at Florida.
When we beat them in what bowl game? Gator Bowl?
Was it the Outback?
I think it was.
One of those four.
You were there,
bowls.
Bud.
Yeah.
Is that where we beat Florida?
I think it was Outback, yeah.
And then he came with Zucker to Illinois.
Right.
Where we didn't play him a whole lot, but we...
I don't think we ever lost to him. Not under Zook.
I don't think we did either.
And then he left to be head coach at New Mexico.
Loxley did.
Yeah. Right.
Zook got fired.
And Loxley's strength, it was real evident once he left Illinois. Illinois' recruiting went downhill real quick.
And Loxley was the head recruiter at Florida as well.
Right.
When they had a really good team.
So that's his forte. I don't know if it's really offensive coordinating or not, but he's renowned for his recruiting ability. I would look to, you know, if he does anything halfway decent between now and the end of the season, I would look for them to retain him as head coach, but you never know.
You never know.
Oh, I think they will, too.
We'll see.
I mean, they played us a good game.
That was a year ago.
Yeah.
Under Edsel.
Locksley, before Locksley went to Florida, he was an assistant at Maryland under the... I'm trying to remember the really big guy, Ralph Friedgen.
Friedgen, there you go.
Was their coach. Locksley was an assistant there for about 5 or 6 years, and he played at Towson, which is located in
Baltimore,
smaller school.
It is Baltimore, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Where's Friedgen now?
I don't know.
Is he in the pros?
I don't know. I think Zook is in the pros. It's one of the, you know, the pros have guys, I guess they call them coaches, who sit in the press box advising the coaches whether to challenge. They watch the replay. That's their whole job.
I know.
Is to watch TV.
Wonder what they get paid to do that.
I don't know. I don't know.
Earl, you and I could do that.
Sure.
Be a good seat for the game.
Yeah.
You're always dry and warm.
It really booze in.
Well, one of the things that'll be interesting about Locksley is we've really recruited Maryland in the last few years.
I'm glad you brought that up.
And it'll be interesting to see if we still are and if Locksley makes a difference, if he stays, if he makes a difference to our ability to bring kids from Maryland. For example, both of our starting safeties are from Maryland.
Yes.
I've got the players listed right here.
Lomax and
but then
Miles
they said
Davis.
Penn State's really working that hard, too.
Are they? Yeah. In Maryland?
Iowa has 7 players from the state of Maryland on its roster, including defensive lineman Darian Cooper, linebacker Eric Grimm.
Oh, I forgot Darian Cooper. Yeah.
Running back Marcel Jolly. Free safety Jordan Lomax, linebacker Steven Manders, strong safety Miles Taylor, and defensive back Omar Truitt. All of them are from Maryland. Guess how many Iowa players are on the Maryland roster?
Well, I would guess none.
The big zero.
Are you serious?
Yeah. No Hawkeye State kids on the Maryland roster. No surprise. I mean, they're going to recruit from out in the East Coast. But we've got 7. From Maryland, which I found to be quite interesting. I didn't know that we had put such emphasis.
No, I didn't either.
Yeah, we have.
Yeah. So who,
and
do you know?
Successfully.
Who recruits out that way for us?
Well, that I can't tell you. I don't know.
Yeah.
While you're talking about coaches, mentioned Minnesota coach.
Jerry Kill resigned today for health reasons, I guess effective immediately. We record the show over the noon hour on Wednesday. It's running at 7 o'clock tonight and on Wednesday. So we haven't heard much more. We know that Jerry Kill has had a series of seizures.
On our local.
Oh, have you?
Yeah.
Well, you know, he's much beloved by his players, and the fans up there really like him.
The fans love him.
Yeah,
It's going to be interesting to see who replaces him, and more importantly, you know, how his health progresses from here. Because you just got to believe somebody suffering seizures like he did. That lifestyle of a Big Ten football coach has got to take its toll. So hopefully, this will be a move in the right direction.
Game last year, a whole stand, Jerry.
Well, it doesn't help when they beat the tar out of the Hawkeyes.
No, I know, but it's still an idea. I've never heard him say Kurt. I mean, it was really. I mean, like the fans planned that.
Well, until he got hurt, Drew Ott got cheers from the crowd at home. Drew.
Yeah, right. I thought they were booing, and I started booing.
You started booing? Bad. Here's another interesting statistic. Iowa is trying to improve to 8-0 for just the second time in school history, which I thought surprised me.
I must ask you.
No. The Hawkeyes were 7-0 in 1985, 1922, in 1921, that's Aubrey Devine, correct?
22 was
Howard Jones.
Well, Devine would have been on that team, along with Duke Slater.
Oh, yeah.
How many did that ever since he have?
He never went 7-0.
Well, see, in those days, they were only playing 9.
Right.
And Evie, 8-0.
In Evie's teams.
There were only 3 teams so far before this year that went 7-0 in Hawkeye history. The 1985 team, the 1922 and 21 teams. Mm-hmm. That's it. I'm sorry.
2009.
In 2009 was the other, and that's the last time a team went 9-0 in Hawkeye history.
Was it Northwestern that ended that streak?
Yeah, broke what's-his-name's ankle in the end zone. Our quarterback, Ricky Stanzi, and then they had to go to Ohio State the next week with a rookie quarterback, and he actually did pretty doggone good.
Was the best he ever played.
That the kid from Keokuk, I'm drawing up.
James Vandenberg.
Vandenberg, yes.
He did play good then.
Yes, he did.
Terrific.
And he completed 2 passes.
Oh, more than that.
Oh, God.
Long passes. That was just.
Yeah, he had some big plays. Yeah. And
I really thought we were going to win that.
That was old Kirk in that game. I know that. Yeah, a lot of coaches over there don't want to hear about new versus old Kirk, and they laugh about it. But I'm telling you what, we had the ball with 45 seconds left at the end of the game, and he took a knee on the road.
Yeah,
and I remember just going, "What the hell?"
Yeah.
There were some other anyway.
Yeah, we wouldn't do that. Not anymore.
That's new Kirk for you. Here's some other statistics to chew on. 3 different Hawkeyes have rushed for over 100 yards in a game this season. They are Jordan Kanziri, 4 times he's done that already, LaShawn Daniels once, and Akram Wadley once. And that's pretty significant.
Mm-hmm.
The last time Iowa had 3 different players rush for over 100 yards per season, in one season, was 2005. Albert Young, 8 times, Sean Green once, and Damian Sims 1 time. That was a pretty formidable backfield to have those 3 guys. Iowa also, I think this is significant, we also have 3 receivers to catch over 100 yards per game this year in one season. Matt Vandenberg 1 time. Tavon Smith once, and Germanic Smith 1 time. 3 players. The last time that happened was 1995, 20 years ago. And those 3 receivers were Tim DeWight, who did it twice that year, Demo Odoms, remember Demosthenes?
Yeah.
And Scott Slutsker, a tight end.
Oh, yes.
That's the last time we had 3 receivers in one season.
Ohio?
Slutsker. Couldn't tell you. Slutsker.
I was
I trust your judgment on that. If you think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ohio.
Yeah.
Well, the key to Saturday's game will be whether Beathard is well enough to move around and throw the ball. And whether he, after he gets hit once or twice, will still be able to move.
But I heard Kurt say last night, a lot of this winning is because of him making our third down by running the ball.
Right.
Absolutely.
And if he can't run the ball.
Huh?
If he can't run with the ball.
But he says he's going to.
Well, it's easy to say.
Until he can't.
I think he's going to play.
We don't know how badly he's hurt. He's going to play. There's no question about that. But how long he can go. I don't think he could have come back in at Northwestern.
No.
I think he was done. The last play, he
did a lot for us.
He was in bad shape.
Yeah.
And it's a good thing we were a ways ahead at that point. Well, the Uyghurs did all right.
Who do we have on your list there that's not going to play because of injury?
I don't have that. We know that
Ike Betker is not going to play. Jordan Kanziri is not going to play.
Definitely not.
I think those are the only 2 who we know are not going to play.
Right.
Then
Doozy's back on.
Drew Ott's not going to play.
No. Who's the ones that are coming back?
Myers has been moved up to a second team.
I think it's
if he can play, he'll probably start. And One of the things that surprised me a little bit is if that happens, they're going to move Cole Crosston to right tackle and presumably put James Daniels back on the bench. And he's done very well. That would move Sean Walsh back to left guard. He had a terrific game at Northwestern at right tackle, which he'd never played. He'd never played tackle. And
do you use sunglasses or anything? Or
me?
Yeah.
No.
Why do you ask?
He just picking people apart. You know.
You mean the binoculars?
Yeah, binoculars. Yeah.
Pat is very observant.
Yeah, that's what I say.
It's why I really enjoy having him on the show because he pays close attention to detail. And it's, in fact, Pat, now that he's brought this up, I would hate to have gone against you in trial because your attention to detail, I would have to say, is flawless. It's amazing what you retain up here.
People actually, my wife and I, we used to play Trivial Pursuit, and people quit playing us.
I believe it.
We got banned from Trivial Pursuit.
So who's better at Trivial Pursuit, you or Betty?
Well, we have different areas of expertise. Her description is, I know a lot about a little, and she knows a little about a lot.
I used to think I was pretty good at that, Trivial Pursuit. I haven't played in a while, though.
No, we haven't.
I've never played at all.
I haven't either. Anyway,
that's one of the things that the coaching staff did last week that was terrific is move Sean Walsh to right tackle. He did an amazing job. Never played
against
that
position.
Against
a top-ranked defense.
Absolutely. And he was playing against a guy who got six sacks last Saturday against Nebraska.
And he stopped him cold.
Absolutely.
I can't think of the player's name for Northwestern, but Press Citizen had a little article about that this morning.
And they moved
Press Citizen.
Moved James Daniels right guard where he'd
Walsh,
did a lot better.
He played pretty good.
Left guard, rather. Welsh.
Okay. Sean Walsh.
Jordan Walsh is the right guard.
It's very confusing to me.
And
Sean
Welsh. Welsh is the left guard. But they moved
for now.
Are they brothers?
Well, it depends
are they
on
brothers?
Whether Boone Michaels plays.
That must be tough for the opponents to prepare. I guess they just say, look at number so-and-so.
Sean Welsh is only a sophomore. I mean, that's one of the great things about our offensive line. The only seniors are Austin Blythe and Jordan Walsh.
And like you pointed out, the things that this offensive line have accomplished against really good teams, like Wisconsin, like Northwestern, it's pretty amazing because of their youth, their inexperience, and being moved around from position to position.
Blocked for two guys that made
all those yards.
Well, I mean, it was
Akram Wadley.
Yeah,
one of the things that is worth, I think, taking some time to watch is Austin Blythe. He's playing center. Snaps the ball,
and then
very often, if the running play is going around in, he's out there leading the blocking.
That's right.
To have a center pull out and lead the blocking on an end sweep.
Yeah.
Or he times it well enough to get downfield on a pass play so that he doesn't get called for illegal receiver downfield until the ball is released. And then he gets down and helps. He's really good.
Well,
my next question is, how do you feel we stack up Saturday as far as injuries?
I don't know what Maryland's got for injuries.
I don't care about them. Isle, how do you feel?
I think Beathard, everything centers or revolves around Beathard's injuries.
Okay.
I think
and
his,
the other ones
I'm going to repeat
fine?
What I've said. No, but Beathard is the linchpin. He's the difference maker in our offense this year. He's what makes things happen. And without his ability to run with abandon, I think it changes things. Now, it's Maryland. They're not very good.
I can't say that. I've watched them twice, and they look pretty good to me.
Yeah. Well, you know.
They were playing Penn State, who's not very good. And they were playing, they got slaughtered by Michigan. Yeah, they looked all right against Ohio State. They still lost by 21 points.
Well.
They give up a lot of yards. And I don't think Ohio State's defense is as good as Iowa's defense. I think Michigan may be the best defensive team in the big on, in the Eastern
their
division.
Michigan's good.
Yeah, and Michigan State's got they've got holes this year.
Boy, they're big.
They're good. Yeah, they've got maybe the best quarterback in the Big Ten, but their special teams continuously let them down. What's that?
I'd take our quarterback.
Well, I'd take a real healthy one right now, and I don't know if we're ever going to see that again this season.
Well, it's going to be very hard for him to get fully healthy.
Right.
What's wrong with him?
It's a groin injury. We don't know specifically what, but the groin impacts the hip area as well as your center. And the groin, the groin muscles, when they're injured, they don't just bounce back. You might feel okay, like there's nothing wrong. And then just like in the Northwestern game when he first got hurt, it was on a short end around on the right side. He didn't get hit. He went out of bounds, didn't get hit very hard at all, but he put the brakes on when he went out of bounds, and that's what hurt him. You could see it.
If you're a running back with an injured groin, you don't play.
Yeah.
And a quarterback doesn't have to run, but in our system, his running is the reason that we won seven straight games, or at least a couple of them, and combined with his passing. I mean, it's a great threat. His ability to throw downfield, he's got a great quick release, strong arm, great snap of the wrist, and that helps open up the running game,
yes,
which
indeed.
Has been terrific.
Didn't he get hurt before the Northwestern game?
Oh, yeah, yes.
Yeah. I think he got hurt, was it Iowa State? Or was it the game at home after that?
I think he's playing fantastic.
I think he got hurt in Pitt.
Mm-hmm.
Pitt, okay.
I think was it Pitt or North Texas?
I'm not positive.
Yeah.
And we probably didn't, because the coaches don't talk about it.
But we saw him limping. I remember seeing him limping in a home game after the Iowa State road victory.
Yeah. One of the things, talk about injuries, but and coaches not talking about it, which I fully understand, one of the things we found out this week that came as a total surprise and a bit of a shock, Tavon Smith had surgery.
Yeah, I know.
It had been described as a sprained knee.
Right.
Well, we found out this week he actually had surgery to have cartilage taken out of his knee. That's more than a sprained knee.
Yeah.
For goodness sakes. And then we were surprised last week. I mean, I could see him warming up with the first team at receiver, and I said, "Well, I think Tavon Smith is going to start." And sure enough, he did.
There he is with his. Observation.
Watch, you know, they run 11-on-11 simulations before the game, and you can tell who's going to start who's second and third teams. One of the things I've said to a couple of people from out of town who've emailed me or called to say, how is Iowa doing it? I said, well, we did it last week with our fourth string running back, which is absolutely true.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Wadley was our fourth string running back.
And he got 200 yards rushing.
And didn't fumble.
Northwestern, let's just repeat this again. Until they played Iowa, the most they'd never given up 100 yards to a single running back. They gave up 204 yards?
Yeah,
to Wadley,
yeah.
The second most rushing yards that Northwestern had given up in a game was the second string running back on that day in Evanston, and that was our third string running back, Derek Mitchell.
Mm-hmm.
He had 74. I mean, this was a vaunted Northwestern defense, and we saw what they did a week later when they went to Nebraska.
Yeah.
They handled the Cornhuskers.
That helped us a lot, I think.
And you mentioned their defensive end, right? Defensive end?
Yeah.
How many sacks did he have?
Six.
Six sacks against Nebraska. And he didn't get any against us.
Didn't get a thing.
This is a very good defensive Hawkeye unit that hasn't got a lot of credit yet. And by now, I don't know if you guys have seen, there are a couple of viral videos going around making fun of the Iowa undefeated record. There's a video specifically of a supposed Alabama fan.
Oh, I've seen that.
With his two young sons. Yeah. And what I don't understand about the video,
I didn't get it.
They've got the boys, the two young sons, wearing Auburn stuff, while the dad's got Alabama gear. But
I didn't get it.
He's literally, the father is trying to explain to his children why Iowa could leapfrog Alabama at the end of the season because they're undefeated. And the little kids are saying, but Daddy, don't they play Michigan, Michigan State, and Ohio State, and Penn State? No. He's crying. The dad's crying because they're in the wrong division. And what they don't take into account, again, strength of schedule. And again, this video is all in good fun.
I don't watch that.
You know, next year we do start playing another Eastern Division team.
Who do we get? Ohio?
Michigan.
Michigan. There we go.
Michigan, next year we get
Penn State.
Michigan, Penn State, and Rutgers.
And who drops off? Indiana?
Indiana Purdue, and Maryland.
Oh, Purdue will always be with us because they're our hated rival.
Well, no, because who's in one of Purdue and Indiana are in the same division. One of them came to the West.
Purdue's in our division, correct?
Right.
I don't think so.
Yeah, I do.
Yes, they are.
Yeah, I think Purdue is.
Yeah.
Well, I thought last weekend's games during the bye week really fell in Iowa's favor. Yeah. Wisconsin beat Illinois. They're going to be ranked again if they aren't. I don't even know if they got back in the rankings this week.
25, I think.
Are they? Northwestern won at Nebraska. That makes those two wins on the road against those teams much more significant if they are ranked.
I thought that Northwestern would be much a better team when they played Iowa. And they showed.
We made them look bad, Earl.
I thought we beat them by 30 points.
Yeah. Made them look bad.
It was a great day.
It was. And you were there to witness it. And then you got to go to Mustard's Last Stand.
Yeah, well, that was before the game.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Maybe that was the good luck charm.
Yeah. Yeah, I was kind of startled when Sunday morning at breakfast, one of my sisters goes online to look at the Gazette to see the stories. And there's her husband's picture and my other brother-in-law's picture. And you can sort of make out me in my white hat with the standing in front of Mustard's Last Stand. Mike Kalas came over and shot a picture. I didn't see him. But
did you get a Chicago dog?
I did.
Aren't those good?
It was great. I'm probably going to come down with cancer, judging by yesterday's news release. I just love those Mustard's Last Stand. They have poppy seed buns, and then they top everything off with celery salt.
Got to have the celery salt. Let me tell you, I use celery salt on a lot of things I make.
Yeah.
I do, because I think it makes a difference.
You lay off that salt. But anyway,
celery salt.
He comes down and tailgates with us.
Mike?
And then every time, the guy that owns the
Mustard's.
Oh, really?
And then every time we go up there, he has five spots for us, for our tents and everything.
Really?
So we got to be real good friends 15 years ago.
In the parking lot right to the east of the stadium, is that where you
east
are?
Of it.
Did any of you go up there for the Northwestern
game? Yeah, Nawan and Hanrahan and a bunch of them.
Marty?
Yeah.
Yep.
I didn't get to go.
This was the first time I've been to the actual Mustard's Last Stand.
Okay.
Always before, I go to the little cart they have there on the street right by the east parking lot. But we went over, we came in from the other side.
It's unique. It's small.
It was
it's
great.
Cramped.
And he won't leave it. He's been offered some big money for that.
Well, I bet he is. To my surprise also, their menu is broader than hot dogs.
Yeah, right.
They got Italian
beef.
One
of my brother-in-law's got a hamburger, and they've got some Italian beef, and they got French fries.
Yeah, but you were there for the dogs.
If you go inside, I was.
You got to get that lime green relish.
The pickle slice and the tomatoes.
Yeah.
It was so big, I had to thin it down to get it in my mouth. But it was great. It was a great day.
Yeah.
Absolutely great day.
And on top of that, Pitt won.
Yeah.
Those are the only three teams on our schedule the entire year that really have a chance of ending up ranked in the top 25. Maryland's never going to be there. Indiana, probably not. Most likely not.
No, they got too many losses.
Purdue, Nebraska, Minnesota, none of them are going to be in the top 25. Our strength of schedule is as strong as it's going to be all year right now. And we needed those teams to win last weekend, I think. Some people disagree with me on Wisconsin, that we want to create more distance by them getting another loss.
I'd like to see them win all the rest of their
games. I agree. As long as we win the rest of our games, we're golden.
We win, right.
We're golden.
We could even afford to lose one.
Right.
But I think Wisconsin's got an easier schedule than we do.
well,
the rest of the season.
That's hard to, yeah, that'd be hard to argue. We've still got to go to Nebraska and to Indiana. I think the Indiana game's going to be more difficult than at Nebraska.
Indiana quarterback can throw.
And it's a matchup issue with them. Big, strong quarterback, yeah. big, strong running back, if they're still healthy by the time we get there. And is that game next week?
Yes.
Yeah.
Haven't announced the time or the TV yet.
No.
Which probably means ABC and ESPN are
boy, that'd be
got
nice.
A hold on it.
That'd be really nice. But first, the Hawks got to get past Maryland, and there's a little payback coming.
Yes, there is.
If you remember last year, we got out to a 14-0 lead on them, correct?
Right off the go.
Looking good, thinking, all right, boom. I don't think we scored again the rest of the day.
Oh, I don't know about that.
No, we did. It was 38-31.
Yeah, we
came back in the second half. We were in a pretty big hole.
Well, it was 38-31.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that was the final.
Well, they put a knot on our head. And
they
It was, in hindsight, that game was a microcosm of the year, of the 2014 season. Losing to teams we should never lose to. We should have never lost to them. Should have never lost to Minnesota the way we did.
Well,
or Nebraska, or Wisconsin.
It's Nebraska.
Or Iowa State. Yeah.
Nebraska, we were at them most of the way.
They're righting the wrongs from last year, this season. And it's it resumes this Saturday at 2:30 against Maryland, the Terrapins. I hope the Hawks are able to make some turtle soup on Saturday. It looks to be cold. Looks to be rainy, windy. It's Halloween. My kids want to wear their costumes.
Well, I'll be in the press box.
They won't be the only ones with costumes.
No.
I'll be in the press box.
Will you?
Yeah, I heard Bump offer that. That's nice of him.
Mm-hmm. 15,000 tickets are left, though.
No. 6,000 I saw this morning.
That's right.
There were at one time.
Yeah.
But they've sold a bunch.
They did.
And Minnesota, there are only single tickets left for the Minnesota game. There's still plenty for Purdue. And plenty for Maryland, but...
But as I watch these ball games, there's open spots all over at every one of these teams, including Ohio State.
Oh, yeah. And Nebraska's in danger of not selling out or of breaking their consecutive sellout streak, which is at 280-some games, dating back to the 70s.
You know, one of the things that has surprised me, Bud, and part of the reason for open spaces is the visiting teams are not bringing the crowds that they used to. Illinois, I was shocked. I bet there were only 1,500 or 2,000 Illinois fans in the stands.
Yeah, almost like they sat in two rows up above.
Well, that's where we assign them. Spread them out.
Yeah, I know. And you could see them real good. Because
and so they don't get a big block of cheering going, which is fine. But it's so close. That I was expecting 5,000 or 6,000 knowing that we had tickets available.
And then Maryland's not going to bring anyone.
No, nobody. Nobody.
And Purdue won't. This is not only in Iowa.
No,
that's what I'm saying.
I saw a lot of empty seats at Nebraska last week against Northwestern. I think a lot of fans left
early.
Our
game at Northwestern, I think, was the biggest crowd I've ever seen at a Northwestern game when we've been there.
Yeah.
But it was still like 47,000.
Yeah, there was empty seats. You could see that.
Well, there was a whole section.
Yeah.
Down by where their students were. They've moved students to the east side.
Oh, okay.
They always used to be on the west side, but it was still a whole section.
I wonder why they did that.
I don't know. They moved. The Iowa fans used to be toward the end zone on the east side. Now they're on the west side.
Uh-huh.
And, of course,
and that's press box side.
Yes.
I don't get that.
And they're Iowa fans in the upper deck at both ends.
And in the south end zone.
Yes.
That's where we often got stuck, sitting there.
I feel sorry for their coach.
Who? Northwestern? Oh, Bud.
Why do you feel sorry? You don't feel sorry for...
I get a charge out of
it. I'm perplexed. I'm flummoxed. Joe, can I swear on public access TV? You're out of your mind.
What I want to know is who designed that stadium. It's the weirdest... worst thing underneath
the oldest looking stadium
it's there. Like a high school stadium They cannot accommodate.
It's worse than that.
It is. Concessions, bathrooms, they're not nearly enough. You wait in line forever in a stadium where there aren't any people. It's ridiculous.
There's no flow to the crowd underneath.
No.
They deserve the 30-point beating.
Yeah, and Fitz deserves everything he's got coming to him. He's so full of himself.
He always says nice things about you. But
he must be a Cub fan, I'm guessing.
Yeah, right.
In fact, I know he is. I saw him sing Take Me Out to the Ball Game at Wrigley Field one game.
Yeah, okay.
Hey, one more Iowa statistic. Iowa punter Dylan Kidd ranks third in the Big Ten with a almost 45-yard average per punt. Maryland's returner, Will Likely, leads the Big Ten, we said earlier, with his average of 20 yards per punt return. That's pretty good. He's got two touchdowns this year, Will Likely. Two punt return touchdowns this year, so watch out for him.
Dylan Kidd is a big part of the difference between this year and last year.
He sure is.
He's had a really outstanding year.
Absolutely true. Let's see here. Iowa limits its opponents to 2.5 yards per rushing carry. That is third best in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Third best in the country. And Iowa has held 6 of its 7 opponents to under 100 yards rushing per game. Can you remember which team got over 100 yards rushing against Iowa?
Must have been Ohio State. Oh, no, this year?
This year.
Oh, I don't know.
Eastern Illinois?
No.
No.
North Texas. They got 183 yards rushing.
They chewed us up around the end in the
second half. I was really starting to wonder what's going on here.
How bad did we beat them?
Badly.
That's what I mean. There wasn't a time you should be mad.
But we ran two passes back for touchdown.
Right. Yeah.
That affected the score a little bit.
What were you drinking?
At Kinnick Stadium? Water.
I feel a little bad about that because that's part of the decision to fire Dan McCartney. Then they got beat about the same score by
from a team that
lower.
Who beat them after us?
Oh, some. It wasn't
like Nice State or somebody like that.
One final statistic. Iowa is tied for the Big Ten lead for interceptions. You know how many they have?
6.
9.
They have 9.
That's pretty awesome. They only had 6 all year last year.
Yeah, okay.
And we already have 9 with 5 games to play. And a big part of that is our star defensive back.
Well, I think we all agree that our defense, as far as I'm, is the best in the nation.
It's one of them so far in statistics.
A gang tackle, I mean, that's part of this game, if you can.
We're going to see a lot of that against Maryland. Defense, gang tackling.
Right.
We're going to see Desmond King probably pick off another pass if that quarterback goes to the air very often. Desmond King is, our all-purpose player. Maryland's got one just like him, except a little shorter, Will Likely. He returns punts, kickoffs. He leads them in interceptions. I don't know if, is he, yeah, he's a senior, Likely.
Oh, no.
We know that Desmond King is a junior. We know that Pat thinks he's going to go pro after this year. I still have my doubts, but we'll see. I hope
it'd be nice if he came back.
Sure would.
He'll be very tempted.
Yeah.
And he'll go through the process and see where he thinks he's going to be, or somebody thinks he's going to be drafted.
But if he stays there and has another good year, the money will be more, won't it?
If he doesn't get injured.
Yeah, but you balance the risk of injury. You balance, I have no idea what his family or economic background is.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of those young men decide to turn pro, sign a contract, and help their family get out of particularly parts of Detroit, which is where he's from.
Yeah. Well, we've got about 15 minutes left. Is that right, Joe? I think that means 15.
Yeah.
We're going to switch gears here. Believe it or not, it is Hawkeye basketball season. Tomorrow night, the Hawkeye men's basketball team opens the exhibition season in Carver Hawkeye Arena at 7 p.m. against a team from Sioux Falls.
Sioux Falls. I don't know. That's
never heard of this team.
I have no idea what division they are. Uh-huh.
Sioux Falls.
I actually tried to look at the game notes to see.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You got to have a ticket.
$5 for adults, but it's part of your ticket package.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm going to take the kids because this is a great opportunity to see all the new players. There are 6 new players on this Hawkeye men's basketball team. And you'll never have a better opportunity to see them in action than tomorrow night. There is one more exhibition game next Friday at Carver Hawkeye.
Who's that?
Mm.
I think it's Augustana.
Augustana, South Dakota.
South Dakota,
yep.
Okay.
The men are playing with a new 30-second shot clock this season, down from 35, which has been since I think they incorporated shot clocks,
That's right, yeah.
I like it.
Yeah, it'll quicken the pace of the game. One thing that I think needs to be pointed out, there are no Saturday home games for the men's basketball team this year.
That's weird.
It's terrible. We heard Gary Barta Monday at lunch explain why, because there is a rule, I don't know if it's Big Ten or NCAA, but they've got to have 48 hours between games. And a lot of these games are played on Thursday nights. Some start at 8, some at 8:30. And very few of the Saturday games are night games. They're mostly day games. So you can't get a game in that 48-hour window. So there are going to be more Sunday games. I looked at the schedule just through December, and there were more 8 and 8:30 starts at home than other start times.
One of the things that's different is you have to look at your schedule or your ticket every game to see what day of the week it is, what time it is. You can't count on anything anymore.
There's no TV for this game tomorrow night. There'll be no TV.
I think it's online.
Yes, it is on, what is it, BTN to go.
Yeah.
If you want to do that. I'm guessing KXIC will have the game.
Yeah, the Iowa Radio Network, Hawkeye Radio Network, whatever it's called, the usual lineup of stations.
Well, it's like Dolphin, football. We've hardly been on the Big Ten Network.
Did you notice last Saturday?
That's why we don't get it on TV.
BTN didn't have a night game.
They didn't have an 11 a.m. game either.
I think that's because the other networks picked all the games up that being played. There were 4 Big Ten teams that had byes last week? So there were
at least 4.
There were only 5 games.
Right.
2 are on ABC.
And the others were either on ESPN
or right.
Well, we had a Big Ten network game at 2:30, right?
Yeah, so that leaves 4 games.
Well, there were 2 ABC games. So that leaves 2 games.
And probably one ESPN 1 and 2.
Yeah, probably. But it was...
It was weird.
It was just
the Big Ten Network didn't have much Big Ten football.
And the only reason I like them, you're on during the week quite a few times.
Right.
You're on these others.
Yeah.
The replays.
I love that the BTN has a program where they run a game in an hour.
In an hour. And I just love that. No commercials. No, I mean, they just
I like it very much. Yeah.
Didn't you think Barty gave a pretty good talk?
Yeah, I did. Yeah. Did you see him that night on KCRG?
I did.
It's online if you want to go see it. He spoke to us at the Monday Morning Quarterback Club this Monday. Gary Barta, the athletic director.
Yeah.
In part, he discussed plans for the West Campus, where a lot of things might end up. He talked about the possibility of the track team moving, the possibility of the women's softball team moving, and the real possibility of the baseball team moving, all to the west side. I'm assuming where soccer and field hockey are now, correct? Where the Hall of Fame is and tennis.
In that area, although I didn't see him on Channel 9.2 Monday, but I had understood the baseball plan to be to knock the facility down, mm-hmm. leave the field. They've spent a lot of money on mm-hmm. that field and rebuild a new stadium around the existing field.
So they'd knock down the old football facility?
No, they'd knock down the existing
baseball
stand.
Oh.
And build a new facility around the existing field.
Hmm.
Because they've spent like $1 million or $2 million on
the
field.
And they also said there will be more restrooms in your area.
Someday.
No, that's in the program.
Well, they haven't designed that expansion yet, but that's part of the
But he mentioned
goal.
that there'd be more.
Yeah. Trust me. As a guy who sat in the north end zone since they remodeled it 25 years ago, there's one men's bathroom, and it floods.
Just one?
Yeah. Yeah. And it floods a lot.
What is this?
In the north end zone of Kinnick Stadium. We have no video monitors anywhere in the north end zone, in the concourse. We have no audio, so if you go and stand in line for, you know, your kid's hot chocolate or go to the bathroom, you miss out on everything. There is absolutely no contact.
Whose fault is this?
Well, it ain't my fault. Unless, I guess, I could have gotten tickets somewhere else without all my friends and sat somewhere where they have video monitors.
Nobody's fault. It's just
we miss.
You don't go down there all the time. You have to go to the restroom.
I got little, you know, I got kids, so yeah, unfortunately, more than I like to.
A big line to wait.
Right.
Can't you wind around and come to the east side or the west side?
Yeah. Yeah, and I have.
Oh, okay.
And I have. Often you have to because the men's bathroom's flooded. I'm telling you, I will give credit. This year, I don't think it's flooded yet. But we've only had three home games, right?
We went 20 days without rain. That's the reason.
Yeah, that's part of it.
What about drinking?
You know, in our end zone, I don't see any of it. Nobody's barfing on us or yelling profanities. My sister and her husband sat one section over from us at the, what was the last home game?
Illinois
game. Mm-hmm. And I guess there were a lot of really negative Hawkeye fans just complaining, constantly
complaining about what?
I really don't know. That's what I asked my sister. She said anything and everything.
Well, the experts, they didn't play the game.
Just complaining, you know, about the coaching, about the whatever. And she did say it really took away from the experience sitting there. We've never experienced that in our section,
ever.
I wonder
what there's been to complain about this year.
Really, no kidding. Let's talk about Iowa women's basketball. That starts up, that season, the exhibition season starts up.
Say, what about the girls?
A week from Sunday.
They went pro.
Sam Logic?
Well, there are three that are playing pro.
Sam got traded from Atlanta to...
Sam Logic played in the WNBA. She got drafted by the Atlanta Dream and traded to...
San Antonio,
whatever their nickname is. The WNBA has a fairly short season.
Just 50 games.
By design, they don't pay a whole lot, but most of the players who are in the WNBA then want to play in Europe or somewhere else
That's
overseas.
Where they make the money.
Mm-hmm. And Sam and Bethany Doolittle are playing on a team in France.
How about that?
Playing on the very same team in France.
The same team.
Melissa Dixon has signed a contract to play on a team in Australia.
The Hawks.
Is that the name?
Yeah, the Hawks.
They start a little later, and she'll go down there in a month or two to play with an Australian team.
I think it's great.
I think the last time we sent somebody to Australia, he didn't ever come back. Steve Carfino.
Yeah. He's a big star down there.
Oh, I guess he is.
He was a basketball star, and then he became a sportscasting star. I think he's still maybe.
He's probably almost retired by now.
Yeah.
I used to know him quite well.
He was a heck of a player.
Oh.
He was a real spark plug. Recruited him.
Great personality, which obviously served him well. And
what's he doing now?
He was a sportscaster in
like
Australia.
The equivalent of ESPN in Australia.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah.
Do they televise over there, too? Or?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
So, women's first exhibition game is a week from Sunday on November 8th at 2 p.m. against Upper Iowa. There'll be no TV. I'm assuming radio will be there.
Yeah, they will.
And there are some interesting rule changes this year for the women's game. Instead of two 20-minute halves, they're going to play four 10-minute quarters.
Have you heard why that is?
I don't. If you read the season ticket brochure they stuck in there, it said something about to make the game more exciting and fast-paced.
Yeah, well, how does that, kind of having four quarters instead of two halves?
And slow it down, I'd think.
It says the breaks between quarters will be 1 minute and 15 seconds. Halftime will be 15 minutes. Teams are awarded two free throws after the fifth foul of each quarter. Each team receives three 30-second timeouts and two 60-second timeouts per half, and four timeouts will carry over to the second half. In overtime, each team receives one 30-second timeout plus any accumulated timeouts not previously used in the fourth quarter.
I think the free throw change, the rules change, will actually hurt us.
Yeah.
Because we've always been one of the best free throw shooting teams, not only in the Big Ten, but in the country. And there's no one and one anymore. So if you were a good free throw shooting team, you often took advantage of a one and one.
Right. Now,
everybody will get two shots after five fouls per quarter. So there's less advantage to being a good free throw shooting team than there used to be.
Now, five fouls after each quarter, like the second quarter, then you start over?
Right.
Yeah.
Instead of less foul shooting.
Instead of seven per half and then going to one and one, you now get, in effect, more fouls.
Right.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Less free throw shooting.
So I think that will invite rougher play.
Yeah, I do too.
Yep.
More quasi-intentional, intentional, unintentional,
don't be changing
unintentional.
That, I think.
I'd hate to have that big girl from Illinois, isn't it?
Minnesota. She's gone now.
Oh,
is she?
She went pro.
She went pro.
Oh. After her sophomore year, she went pro.
Oh, my God.
What was her name? Zowie B.
She was big.
Yes, she was.
She was very good.
Now, here's another new rule. Music can be played during any dead ball.
I don't know exactly what that change is.
Yeah. Well, as the brochure stated, to make women's basketball more exciting.
Yeah.
Now, okay. Music can be played.
The band can, or the PA can,
or
blast out music.
A lot of places don't have a band.
How many timeouts?
Just dead ball.
How many timeouts are there allowed?
They're each, okay.
They've actually cut that down, both for men and women. And one of the changes is the coaches can't call timeout anymore.
Good.
Only the players can call timeout.
Five per half.
You know, I think that's a distinction without a difference, because the coaches will simply yell out to a player, call timeout, and the player will call it instead of the referee. It'll just,
and this is just for the women's game.
Add another second. And no men, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Huh.
Hmm. That rule changes men as well.
We've got about 4 minutes to talk
keep
about.
Keep them off the floor.
No, I won't.
No.
No. If anything, it'll get them more on the floor while they're telling their players to call timeout.
Yeah.
You know, when they signal a tee, the official won't call timeout. Right. The player will have to see it and call it.
That's right.
Certain referees will call it a mile change.
And leave the other team go.
We've got about 3 minutes to talk about high school football. All three Iowa City high schools are hosting home playoff games tonight. As soon as this show's over in a couple minutes, all of them start at 7 o'clock. All three city teams are playing opponents with 4-5 records. City High with a 6-3 record after a big win at Muscatine last week.
Yes.
42-41, they avenged last year's loss that kept them out of the playoffs. They're going to host Linmar. This is the 22nd time in 24 years that City High has been in the playoffs. Nobody in Iowa City can touch that record. West High, who has a 3-6 record, lost its season finale at Pleasant Valley, a very tough, top-ranked Pleasant Valley, 35-20 last Friday, but still have earned a home playoff game with a second-place district finish after a very challenging schedule that included losses to four district champions and two district runner-ups. They are going to host Cedar Rapids Prairie tonight in just a few minutes. And then finally, number one ranked Regina with an 8-1 record went on the road at Pella Christian and beat them in a fairly competitive game, 31-14. They are going to host Bellevue tonight, not Bellevue Marquette, but Bellevue, also with a 4-5 record. All games start at 7 o'clock, and get out there and support your favorite local high school team. We've run out of time. We'll be back next week. On behalf of Pat White, Bud Supel, and Earl Murphy, I am Dirk Keller, thanking you for watching Sports Opinion every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. and every Sunday night at 6 p.m. right here on Channel 18. If you want to review any of the other shows, go to patv.tv, or you can always go to my Facebook page, or I put them on Pat's Facebook page, whether he knows it or not. We appreciate you tuning in. Next week, Bob Boyd will be back, and until then, thanks for watching, and remember this, go Hawks. Make some turtle soup this weekend for Halloween.
And turn your clock back.
Is that this weekend?
Yep.
Okay.
Sunday?